The incantation has been cast. The spell has been brought to reality, and the summoning circle is here, and we'd like to thank Jason Bulmahn for being the subject of our conjuration this day. How you doing, Jeff?
That reminds me of that old bit of, like, what would you have to put in the circle to summon me? And for me, it would probably be a nice glass of scotch, a bag of dice, and a can of haggis.
Oh, okay. I was going to say some sort of delicious sausage.
Or a sausage, yeah, no, or a nice steak. Yeah, it'll all work, yeah.
Good substitutes, yeah. Good substitutes. So welcome to the show.
Hey.
We are very happy to have you as a little bonus to offer to the Busters to talk to us a little bit about the Fall of Plaguestone, which is, of course, sure, the adventure that you wrote that we're going to be playing. You know, I wanted to basically come at you from the point of view of the ignorant nerd interviewer who doesn't know anything about you. No, I'm playing. Jason and I have known each other for many years, and instead, what I was thinking about is, you do a million of these things. You've had to front man and talk about Paizo and Pathfinder forever through multiple iterations of the game. And is there a question that stands out in your mind as the, man, I wish somebody would finally ask me this one so I could talk about that? Is there one of those questions that you haven't able to get out of your system?
You know, I get, you are right. I do a lot of interviews talking about our game and our products and, you know, kind of what I do. The challenging thing is, right, you know, you do so many of them and eventually people have covered everything, right? You know, how'd you get your start in gaming? You know, how'd you get your start at Paizo? How did Pathfinder, the role-playing game, come about? And so, you know, just off the cuff, you know, I guess I don't get a lot of questions about what other games I enjoy and stuff like that. I mean, sometimes I do, but that's pretty infrequent. How did I get my start in role-playing? You know, a lot of that is very bog-standard answers. Yeah, I started with D&D, just like everybody else did in the mid-80s. You know, but in reality, I cut my teeth kind of much more deeply playing Battletech and GURPS, right? After, you know, we played around with D&D, but the first real full-fledged gaming group I ever played with was playing Battletech. We were playing MechWarrior. And I had no idea what I was doing. And they were like, yeah, come and, you know, you'll need to have a mech and stuff like that. And
how,
I didn't
how
know.
Old were you? How old were you, Jason, when you were playing that? How old were you?
Maybe 13 after D&D. So D&D for me started when I was in middle school, and a friend of mine, a local kid at the school, brought me into play, and we just played together. And then I picked up a box set and played with another friend, you know, but it was mostly just one-on-one dungeon crawly kind of stuff. And the first real group I joined was like, yeah, we don't play that D&D stuff. We're playing MechWarrior. And I'm like, what's a MechWarrior? And so I show up and I'm like so exuberant that, you know, I show up and I've picked my own mech, not realizing that that's not really how the game works. Like, it's not like building a character where you pick a mech and just get one. The person running it has to decide what mech is available in the lance, and, you know, there's right. The tactical part, and then we were also doing the role-playing part. So I showed up with, like, and I don't know if anybody or your fans know anything about Battletech, but I showed up with an archer, which is a nice mid-weight mech, but I had painted it, but because I didn't know anything about the story, I painted it like it was this cool new-looking mech, and that's not how Battletech works. Like, all the mechs are, like, old right. And constantly being patched and beat up, and mine was all shiny because I had painted it with, like, car enamel paints. It was terrible.
It looked like a Duster's model.
it looked like a little green and brown car, and it was just like everybody made fun of me, and I. So there you go. There's a gaming story. I'm not sure. I've ever told.
That is awesome. Isn't correct me if I'm wrong, but wasn't the archer the one that had the four autocannons?
No. The archer was the missile.
Oh, no, that's a rifle.
It had two LRM 20s, if I recall correctly. And cartridge. It had the big shoulder pads filled with missiles, and not at all appropriate for a starter mech either. No, like now, looking back at it, I'm like, really? What am I going to do the whole time? Just sit way in the back? Like, it was ridiculous. It was ridiculous.
I had no idea that you ever played in a FOSSA RPG campaign. I also had one of those in the past as well. So that's good stuff.
Back in the 80s, we played everything we could get our hands on, right? We bounced around between systems every few months.
Yeah.
So what else are you playing now? To your question. What else?
Well, I mean, frankly, because of the pandemic, I'm not playing much. I've had, you know, plenty of streamed games and stuff like that, and most of that's Pathfinder, and that's what I have time for, you know, outside the job. But I do like to play. I've been collecting a lot of like indie and zine games and trying to support that industry by pushing them with my social media and stuff, because I think it's really important. I think the indie scene and the zine scene are really important to the growth of this industry. It's a great way for folks who aren't, you know, frankly, you know, old stodgy white dudes who started in the 80s, right? You know, it's a great way to bring diversity into our field because it's a lot lower barrier to entry than 600 page offset print giant rule books, right? And I'm not saying that folks can't do those too. They certainly can. Sure. And there's certainly been plenty of success stories. But lower barrier to entry means that a lot more people can get into designing their own games, which I'm really for. So, you know, I've been buying a lot of those lately, and I hope to get to play a bunch of them, but, you know, we're not quite.
Very cool. And hopefully a lot of those.
You're looking forward to playing that you haven't had, that you're like, man, I want to play this, but I haven't had a chance to?
Mothership looks like a lot of fun, and a lot of people do Mothership supplements. It's like a horror RPG, space RPG. That one looks like a lot of fun. What else did I just pick up? UVC I just picked up recently. I'd like to, there's just a whole bunch. Most of them have names that if I rattled them off, you wouldn't recognize. So they are very small, but I do a lot of shopping in a place called Exalted Funeral. They cater almost exclusively to zines and indie titles. And they got a lot of great stuff.
Awesome. And I'm sure the necessity of people's side hustle at this time more than ever, people making this kind of content, these content creators, we definitely want to support them. Let's shift gears into that mainstream industry giant that is Pathfinder and Paizo.
Well, we do what we can.
So we're playing Fall of Plaguestone for our very first playgroup for Azmyth Busters. Super excited about it. And I wanted to ask you just a couple of basics, like why that story? Why did you want to launch that particular tale for Pathfinder 2? And do you have any insights that you want to share? Now, of course, back in the day, we called it spoilerific stuff, right? We want to avoid spoilerific because people will see this video before they see the play sessions.
Sure.
But if there's insight, if there's any kind of foundational things why you guys went in the direction you did, I would love to hear that.
I think, you know, when we were sitting down to play test Pathfinder 2nd Edition, one of the first play tests that happened internally was ran by me. And I had written this, you know, hokey little story about folks going to this small town and having kind of misadventures. And frankly, it was mainly there so I could do what was called the proof of concept test. And that was, we had the nascent kind of engine for 2nd Edition taped together, and we had just enough components for everyone to be able to make a character. They didn't have choices, right? It was like none of the options of the game were there yet. But we had enough that you could build a fighter and a rogue and a cleric and a wizard. And we had so many people in the group that we had multiple like rogues and multiple fighters. And, you know, because I think there was like 7 people in it or something, just because folks wanted to see how it played, what the feel was.
Right.
Because in designing a game of this scope, we start with kind of that. We build a proof of concept to test our new design assumptions. And we follow that up then with kind of a series of sprints where we're building a minimum viable playthrough from beginning to end. Video games do this as well, where they're just trying to build the through line before they build depth to it. And for us, we then went into building kind of, you know, oh, we're going to build the four classes all the way from 1 to 20 now. And once we have that, now we're going to test it at various spots to make sure that all of our assumptions are lining up. So while all that's happening, I'm running this proof of concept game and it starts gelling and, you know, we're having a good time with it. And the story was very peculiar. It involved this town of kind of, frankly, kind of bumpkins who, you know, you're not in a big city, you're in a small place and they've got small town troubles, but there's hints of something much larger going on. And that story dealt with undead and a sinister secret for the town's history. That's not Plaguestone, but there were definitely a lot of elements in there that went into Plaguestone. Because ultimately what happened was we decided, you know, when I was sitting down to be like, okay, what's the first standalone adventure for the new edition of the game? What are we trying to say? And I wanted to start kind of small. I didn't want it to be, you know, we had an adventure path that was going to launch at the same time. And I knew that was going to be a big thing because it's an adventure path and it takes you from first to 20th level. And I'm like, this isn't going to do that. This module is going to start you at first and you're going to end at like fourth. You're not world shaking heroes by the end of it. And I was like, what kind of story can I tell in that space? And the answer was, I want to tell the story about how your group became a group.
Nice.
Not the story about how they saved the world, not the story about how, you know, they founded their own kingdom. Nope, none of that.
Yeah.
I wanted to tell the story about how four strangers who start in the back of a wagon, and that's the only spoiler I'll give you, somehow find themselves relying on each other and, you know, trusting each other and coming together in a town that has, that isn't the biggest town in the world, that is, although it's facing very serious threats, it's still small. It's like, if this town vanishes off the map, passing merchants will note it, and that will be it. The region will not be destabilized. The kingdom will not be toppled. The, you know, the demon lord of gluttony will not be released.
Nope. Photographers will make a note of it on their maps and move on.
They won't even make a note. They'll just scratch it out. And yeah, so, you know, but it's important to them and it's important to you. And it becomes that tale you tell at the tavern about how four strangers sitting in the back of the wagon became best of friends.
Very awesome.
And that's a story we don't see enough of. Like I get that, like, a lot of adventurers are like, don't start with the cliche of a wizard hires you in a tavern and that's how you become heroes. And I'm like, yeah, sure. But instead, I'm going to do the entire concept of how did these people meet as an adventure. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, admittedly, you're right. You know, after three play sessions, they all know each other. They're all working together and stuff like that. But I kind of took it as a holistic thing of, like, you know what? Once this adventure is over, the players very well likely could go their separate ways. But at the end of it, I want them to go, no, we're together now, right? That was the point.
We're in the band.
Yeah.
That's awesome. You know, it's really funny. It's funny how coincidences and social media and things work. As I started reading Plaguestone and preparing for it and looking at it, in my Instagram feed this morning, there was a picture of an actual Plaguestone that they were, some historical site was, and I was going through and I was like, oh wow, I recognize that right off the bat because of Jason's module. I hadn't really clued in on that you had taken a historically accurate thing and kind of built off of that.
So and this is a mild spoiler, but it's in the title. So a Plaguestone, for those who aren't in the know, was actually a thing. And what it was a rock in the middle of town where if you had people who had the plague, they didn't know how you caught it. They didn't quite understand how it spread, but they knew that it spread from person to person. And as a result, you take the people who are sick, you isolate them. That's the best you can do. That's the only thing they had, you know, lessons I wish we would learn more of today. But what would happen is the people who are isolated, they still wanted you know, they still had needs. They still needed food. They still needed medicine. They still needed supplies. And the Plague Stone was a way for them to still buy things or get things. People would leave things at the Plague Stone. Those who were infected would come to the Plague Stone. And if they needed to pay for it, they would drop their coins in a bowl that was in the center of it. And in that bowl, they would usually place like vinegar or something just to sterilize whatever they had touched, because that's they knew that somehow it was passing person to person, and they didn't want to touch the stuff they had touched. They didn't want to, you know, they didn't want to talk to them. So that's what the Plague Stone was. And and unsurprisingly, this town that you arrive at in this adventure has a Plague Stone, because it suffered from a very terrible plague many years past.
Yeah, good stuff. Good stuff. So I had mentioned to you, and we talked about it earlier, that I had been quite resistant to converting or adopting Pathfinder 2, only because I, you know, had a decade and thousands of dollars invested in Pathfinder 1, and I'm playing D&D, and here's this other system. You guys released this other system. So I was not, it's not an older system. It only came out in 2019. So it's only been out a couple years, right? So I'm usually an early adopter, and I wasn't this time. And I'm kind of feeling a little bit of regret about that, because now the more I'm learning the system, the more I'm really enjoying it and really appreciating it. And so I just wanted to give you props. And I tell Steven all the time whenever I get the opportunity that the more I read, the more I appreciate it, and am looking forward to really playing the system.
Yeah, well, I mean, Steven obviously had a huge hand in shaping the system and how it came together. And, you know, so I think he knows a bit about the adventure, because he was obviously there as I was writing it and putting
it together. Well, that's just it. When I pitched him the idea of playing in the game, he said, "I honestly don't know anything about it. I know the basic story." He goes, "I never read it. I don't know the adventures. I never had my head in it." So.
It got edited and developed by someone else. So that doesn't surprise me. Oftentimes, you know, at a company the size of Paizo, folks will work on a thing and everything else is happening simultaneously. And in this case, simultaneously meant the core rulebook and the bestiary were happening at the same time. Right. So Plaguestone did not go through the kind of game rules team insofar as it went through me. Right, you know, as I was writing it. Mm-hmm. So most of the members of the team were actually a little isolated from it. So I think it's going to work out. You know, I expect you to, you know, kill Steven with my adventure. That's the least you can do for me. Don't tell him.
We'll edit that part out, I promise.
Yeah, oh, sure. Yes, I'm sure. Yeah. I'll pause for edit.
Yes,
okay. We'll put it on. Uh-huh. No, I think, you know, as far as, you know, folks, you know, enjoying first edition. Yeah. I mean, why? Listen, we put out a Ferrari, you know, 10 years ago. You still like the Ferrari. I'm not going to complain. Right. You know, it's a good game. Pathfinder First Edition was a good game. People still like it. People still like to play it. Great. You know, play the game that you enjoy. Life's too short to get too upset about it. We've put out a new version. I like the new version. I think it's an improvement. But that doesn't mean the old game still isn't good, right? You know, so, you know, I think, you know, Pathfinder 2nd Edition was really our chance to kind of rebuild the car, you know, just stick with the analogy, from the ground up, to really kind of remake the game into the game we really wanted it to be, and to take, you know, 10 years of our design innovation and make sure that they had a place within the rules frame from minute one, right? Archetypes were not in the Pathfinder First Edition core rulebook because we hadn't invented them yet. And as a result, they were always kind of a bolt-on. They worked, they were good, but they weren't integral to the system. The system wasn't built with the understanding that they existed. And this time around, Second Edition allowed us to kind of take a step back and go, how do we build a system that's holistically complete, trying to do everything we want it to do? And, you know, it took us 3 years, but I think we got there. And, you know, fundamentally, it's a game I can teach in 5 minutes. And, you know, you can sit down with a pre-generated character and be rolling dice, you know, in an amount of time that is shorter than this interview. And that's a big deal, right? You couldn't necessarily do that with First Edition. First Edition had a lot of kind of fidgety rules, and they were good, and it worked. But you sometimes you go, isn't there a better way? And sometimes yeah. there is, right?
What is your proudest? What's the fix that you most are proud of as far as something you isolated about Pathfinder 1 that didn't really work? You wanted to improve on it. What's the best improvement the new system?
Well, to give credit to Stephen, because he was such a huge proponent of it, the three action economy system is brilliant and changes the game. It removes kind of all of the sticky widgets and all the confusing little bits about a move and a standard and a full round and a swift and a quick and a free and we just got rid of all of it and went with you get three actions and one reaction and that's it. That's your turn. How do you want to spend your three actions? You want to move, attack, move? Great. You want to attack, attack, attack? Great. You want to, you know, spend two actions to use your special ability and then, you know, get out a potion? Great. You know, it's more of a narrative flow. I think the other thing that is combined with, there are two other changes. The stool of what makes the three-legged stool of what makes Pathfinder 2E awesome. One of them is that. One is the proficiency system, which is universalized across characters. So if you say, I'm trained at wearing chainmail, I know how to calculate your AC because it's your level plus two plus your dex plus the chainmail's bonus. If I say, I'm trained at stealth, it's the exact same formula. It's your level plus two plus your dex instead. And if you happen to have an item that gives you a bonus at stealth, you would add that too. And that formula is everywhere. Oh, I'm a master at, you know, casting arcane spells. Well, I know the DC is 10 plus your level plus six because master, not trained, plus your int plus any item that might give you a bonus, right? So like just universalizing that formula, if you look back at first edition, right? And you look at, you know, saving throws, you had two formulas. One was one third your level. The other one was one half your level plus two. If you look at attack rolls, one was equal to your level. One was three quarters your level. One was half your level. All of these different formulas meant you needed tables for everything. That's inherently more complicated. It's not bad. It's not wrong. It's just harder for people to learn. So that's the second. And then the third is the way that we changed kind of degrees of success. And this is the one that isn't obvious at first for a lot of folks, but it really comes into its own at the table. In first edition, you beat a number, you beat the DC, you succeed, you fail. You miss it, you fail. That's it. Right. In second edition, if you beat it by 10 or more, it's a critical success. If you fail it by 10 or more, it's a critical failure. If you roll a 20, you still do the math as normal, but treat the success as one category better. Uh-huh. If you roll a 1, you do the math and treat your success as one category worse.
Right.
And what this does is it means that on every die roll, there is drama because... Oh, I got a 32. Is that enough? Is that a crit? It wasn't a 20, but I don't know until the GM tells me. The fireball got thrown at me and I rolled a 2 that comes out to a 12. God, I hope the DC wasn't 22, because if it is, I just crit failed. And not everything has a crit success or crit failure effect. Sometimes it's just, hey, a failure is a failure, you know.
Right.
You can't miss harder than a miss, usually, right? It's not like a crit failure means you throw your weapon, right? But it does mean that there's a greater degree of storytelling based on the die rolls as well, right? So, you know, oh, you made that skill check to climb the tree. Cool. Yeah, you get up there. You know, it takes you, you know, your two of your actions to get up there. Oh, you crit succeeded. You make it up in one. You climb up there as if you were born in a tree. And, you know, now you're perched up there ready to strike, right? It allows for different storytelling. And it allowed us to balance the spells in a way that actually makes spellcasters work, because we could put some of the most deleterious spells and we could keep them at the right level, but put the worst of it behind crit failure, right? So, but it also opened up for us to doing some things on success versus crit success. So like a fireball, for example, does No damage on a critical success on the saving throw, half damage on a success, normal damage on a failure, and double damage on a critical failure. That makes a fireball actually really devastatingly powerful if foes crit fail.
Yeah.
And because level is baked into everything, this is how all three of these things start to work together. Because level is baked into things, when you fireball a bunch of foes who are lower level than you, their level is lower, which means their saving throw is significantly lower, which means their chance of critical failure is lower, which means you'll wipe a bunch of them off the board, which is what you want to have happen when the wizard is fighting a bunch of, you know, level 2 orcs and he's level 8, right? You want to just wipe those things out. But the reverse is also true then when you're fighting the big bad guy, it's going to crit fail almost never, which is what you want because it's one big powerful bad guy and you don't want it to disappear off the battlefield in one roll. So all those things put together makes for a game that kind of lives up to the storytelling we want to do and allows us to kind of have the narrative that we all want to see in our head. And is there still a situation where, you know, the big bad guy bounces a one and it's his worst save and that turns into a crit fail and it gets wiped out at the beginning of a fight? It can happen. But it's not nearly as common as just like, oh, he failed, so that's it, right? You know, he's paralyzed now, rocket tag, we're done, right? You know,
right.
So it's fun.
I love it. I love the analogy of the three-legged stool. And when people come to me and they say, well, what's the biggest difference? I'm like, well, there's a lot of difference from my perspective. Behind the screen and running the game, there's some significant changes. I got to say, one of the things initially that I really love is the way you've changed initiative. And you've used the fact that you can use different skills and bring different things depending upon if you're in exploration mode and you're stealthing around, you could substitute your stealth skill for your initiative roll or your perception check. And I do like that. I do like that a lot. That kind of clicks in my brain as making a whole lot of sense.
Until you've played it, there's another thing that's in the same vein. So the initiative change is one thing. Right. You know, being able to use, you know, one of my favorites is, oh, you're in the middle of a gala, you know, a party. Everyone's in masquerade costumes and there's an assassin in there and they're trying to knife you. Everyone can roll perception to attempt to spot the person. But if you happen to have a society skill that's really high, you might notice the one person who doesn't belong here. Right. Oh. And that can be your initiative. Right.
Fantastic.
There's a lot of different ways you can do that sort of stuff. Now, players that have super high perceptions, they're going to be like, yeah, whatever. I don't care. I'm rolling perception because that's the best thing I got. But sometimes you do find that characters that are really invested in certain skills then can use those things. It's a change in the game's kind of narrative texture. Another one that we put in there was how characters generally interact at the end of a fight. So at the end of a combat, you know, in first edition, you might be like, well, our spell durations are ticking, so let's keep moving. And you would end up with a thing where you pile all the spells on you and you run through as many dungeon rooms as possible and then you rest. Well, we kind of identified that as a bit of a problem just from everyone's shared storytelling, right? Yeah. You know, oh, we adventured for 8 minutes and now we're going to go nap for 23 hours and 52 minutes.
Yeah,
and then we're going to adventure for another 8 minutes. Well, I mean, that's hyperbole, but you get the drift.
Of course.
In second edition, we changed that in that, first of all, a lot of those buff spells are not going to stack with each other. So you're never going to want more than one or two. So they're going to go further. But between fights, we also incentivized you to take a breather, to stop, to gather yourself back together and get ready for the next room. So almost every character has something they can do between fights that generally is about a 10-minute activity that is like, oh, the fighter's shield got dented. Well, you can use, you know, the skills that you have to fix the dent in your armor, and it takes about, what a surprise, 10 minutes. Oh, the wizard cast one of their focus spells, and focus spells are a type of spell that to cast it, you just spend a focus point. And you can get a focus point back by spending 10 minutes. Oh, the characters are wounded. Well, the medicine skill takes 10 minutes to use and restores some hit points. So everybody kind of has a reason to kind of stop between fights, take a breather. You know, their characters break out some trail rations, get ready for the next fight, bandage up some wounds, beat out their shield, you know, do some prayers to their deities, and then they're on to fight more. But the real narrative change is when the story won't let them do that. So the characters will get in a rhythm, they'll get used to doing it, and then they'll find themselves in a place where they can't. And now they know the pressure is really on because they can't go into the fight at peak, the next fight at peak performance. They're going to go in down some resources. They're going to go in a little shorthanded. We saw that people in first edition really liked going into fights at full hit points, right? No surprise. I mean, players want to survive. We don't have a problem with that.
Sure.
But we wanted to give a better narrative reason for them to kind of patch themselves up and get ready for the next thing instead of just carrying with you a wand of Cure Light Wounds and drinking it like, you know, Gatorade between the fight. Right. So, you know, it's things like that where there was a very deliberative approach to the game and how the game creates a story. It seems obvious, but it you'd be surprised how easy it is to just be like, well, that solution works, so we'll just do that without really fully realizing what it means to the story to do it differently.
It seems obvious when you say it like that, but when you look back at the past 20 years of how RPGs have manifested, it wasn't so obvious, and a lot of the designs perpetuated that. So that's very, very good stuff.
Yeah, you know, the team that we put together to make this game happen really was excellent and very deliberative about how does game mechanics equate to the narrative and the story that we're all sharing. Because ultimately, the game is there to help you tell stories. And if the game is telling a different story than everyone around the table wants to tell, there's a mismatch there and you need to fix it. So, that's what we did.
Cool. Well, that's awesome. That's all good stuff. And I think that's going to be really helpful both for viewers who are on the fence like I was and considering maybe picking up Pathfinder 2. Certainly watching us play The Fall of Plaguestone, we hope we'll get people into the mode and in the mood. So in closing, before we release the spirits and let the four points of the cardinal release back into the ethos, before we do that and release you from your summoning spell, my friend, I want to ask you a few questions that are not necessarily gaming related. More about you. So the three easy questions are: what are you reading? What music are you listening to currently? And do you have a food that inspires your creativity? If you've got to sit down and bust out 4,000 words, what is the meal that you treat yourself to?
Well, so as far as what I'm reading right now, I've got quite the pile of books that I'm like halfway into this one and two-thirds into that one. There's always a few game design books in there. Right now, I'm focused kind of on, frankly, screenwriting and story building books because I've been running so many live plays and I kind of approach them more like putting together a screenplay than I do an RPG, oddly, because I have, you know, a certain amount of airtime and I have to hit certain story beats, and to create good dramatic tension, I'm trying to get upbeats and downbeats and the contrast between them creates good narrative tension. And, you know, so I'm reading a lot about that.
That's awesome.
I'm always, you know, trying to get caught up on classics as well. You know, mostly like science fiction and fantasy classics. I keep buying more, but I never end up reading a lot of them. So, you know, my book pile is kind of all over the place right now, and I'm totally spacing on the name of the six books that are sitting right in that room.
But you are normally as a general rule, you consume multiple books at once. You're not the kind of person that sits down and tears through a book and then picks up the next and tears through a book. Like,
yeah. Well, and I'm kind of all over the place too, right? I'll read kind of more serious works of fiction at the same time as I'm reading old Star Trek tie-in novels that frankly are not good. But I read them anyway because I love Star Trek. Like I'm currently trying to struggle and force myself to read through the books about Khan, but man, the narrative frame they pick for them is just awful. It's bad. And I'm having a trouble finishing it. I doubt I will. I've got Kalis on the pile next. I want to read that one. So, I've got that kind of stuff, but I also have, Terry Pratchett. I have like 12 Terry Pratchett books I'm trying to work my way through. So I'm kind of all over the place, and I read, kind of more modern, like, science fiction. I'm trying to round out my reading on like new and upcoming science fiction and fantasy authors that are frankly not European or American, right? I'm trying to branch out, and there's a number of really great Asian authors that have written some really fantastic science fiction books. I have the Three Body Problem is on my pile right now. Three Body Solution. But spacing on the name. So anyway, I'm all over the place. I got a big pile of books. I never read just one book at once. Nice. So there's that. Musically, most of my musical tastes are locked into what I loved when I was, 18. So I listen to a lot of like old industrial and, stuff I listened to back in Milwaukee. But frankly, I don't really listen to anything other than instrumentals when I'm writing or working. I found that if I listen to music with lyrics, I end up typing the lyrics, or it muddles the speech center in my brain, and I end up not being able to type. So I listen to a lot of like soundtracks and instrumentals and classical and stuff like that. Just pleasant, dramatic music to float around in the background. That tends to be what I listen to when I work.
Right. So for the industrial, did you give me a flavor of that? Did you do like any Frontline Assembly, Front 242, that kind of stuff? KMFDM?
So like my big band is Nine Inch Nails, and I'm not sure you would call them industrial anymore.
No, I mean, I think when Trent started, he was considered industrial. I certainly, his first, Pretty Hate Machine, to me, that's quintessential industrial.
That album spins in this room at least once a week.
It's brilliance. track to track, it's brilliance. You can't.
Yeah, yeah. No between that and Burn. Those two are my favorite, but I also love Tool. I love, I did Dally and some of the more German industrial stuff for a while, like Liebach and, all that kind of stuff, but none of that really stuck as much. So that's kind of my jam. I've seen Nine Inch Nails in concert more times than I can count. So
nice.
They're kind of my favorite band. So
nice. Very nice.
And frankly, I also kind of blame gaming for that too, because I got introduced to it by my vampire GM in high school, who would play Pretty Hate Machine in the background while we were playing Vampire. And frankly, that album's pretty kick-ass for Vampire. Like for an RPG soundtrack, you can't go wrong with Pretty Hate Machine.
well played, vampire GM, whoever you are.
Yeah. So that's music and food.
Yeah,
boy. I'll go one of two ways on this. I'm a huge fan of Scotland. So I mentioned haggis earlier, and I realized I said can, and I'm sure there's some people who are like, what? And I'm like, I realized that's the only way I can get it here in the US is by can. There aren't exactly very many places, although a local butcher did make me a haggis here recently. So that was delicious. So I do love Scottish food. But I'm also big into German food. I love cooking for myself too. I cook a lot, or at least I try to. Any chance I can get to bust out and use my sous vide, I'm there.
Nice.
It's a delightful device. It makes everything better. Between that and a handful of other kitchen gadgets, I can kind of do whatever I want. A good air fryer, a good pressure cooker, make it happen. I don't know that there's one go-to right now specifically. But for me, a good meal is usually enough to kind of get me moving. usually a damn fine steak will get me there. Homemade brats or something like that, they're always good.
Okay.
I haven't done those in a while. I should do those again.
And what's your scotch of choice right now? You had mentioned a good scotch earlier. What's your scotch of choice right now?
So scotch for me right now is a little weird, because I joined one of these scotch clubs, and what it is there's all these distilleries over in Scotland. And whenever they make scotch, right, they're doing barrels and they put them in a warehouse for 12 years. And then they open them up and they're like, cool, let's make our brand of scotch. So, you know, Ardbeg or, you know, Lafroy or, you know, Macallan or whatever. But not every barrel comes out right. Some of them come out weird. And they're not bad. They're just not the right taste, right? Because it's sat in a barrel and things can happen in there. And so those barrels can't go into the bottles, right? They can't, this isn't their flavor. So they end up selling them to these clubs and you can join the club and then the club will take those bottles, those barrels, bottle them up and sell them. So what's my favorite scotch right now? A 53.168 because they all go by codes. But if I had to give you a name of a distillery I like, I'm still a huge, gigantic fan of Talisker. Located up on the Isle of Skye. It is a delicious scotch. It's got a nice bit of, it's got a nice whiff of smoke, but the sea salty, briny back notes to it really, really bring me home. I love the Isle of Skye and I love Talisker. So that's where
fantastic.
I'm at.
Fantastic. Fantastic. Well, we're excited to have had you here definitely for this. And to I'm looking forward to playing the module. I'm excited about that. And maybe if the arcanes align in the future, we might pull you out of your GM's chair, put you in a player's chair, and maybe get you at my game table as a player. So that would be fantastic in the future. But thank you for joining us, certainly. We're looking forward to it. And, you know, maybe I might rattle your cage post-adventure just for kind of a little a wrap-up kind of thing.
Sure.
You know,
I'd love to see how it goes and see how many of them die at a certain encounter or two that I have in mind.
Yeah, we've already talked about off-camera, yes.
Yes. Yeah, yeah.
All right.
You know the ones I'm talking about.
Absolutely. Busters, as always, like, comment, subscribe, tell your friends. Thank you, Jason, for joining us today. And thank you guys for tuning in and for watching.